चलो गिव द हेडिंग डिस्पर्शन एंड राइट ऑल द पॉइंट्स अलोंग विद मी। नाउ व्हेन वी टॉक अबाउट डिस्पर्शन इट हेल्प्स अस टू फाइंड स्कैटरनेस और variability in the given data. Okay, if I want to understand whether the data is having high variations or lower variations, so that can be done with the help of measures of dispersion. There are two basic kinds of measures of dispersions, we can say. Absolute measures and the relative measures of dispersion. Under each of them, there are four parts, so we will be seeing all the four parts of each, and then we will also see what are the basic differences between these two measures of dispersion. The first is range, the second is mean deviation, you can write it as MD. The third is quartile deviation, which you can write as QD. And the fourth one that you have is the standard deviation, denoted as ST. Now, under relative measures, the first that you are having is called as coefficient of range, the second is coefficient of mean deviation. Next is coefficient of quartile deviation, and the last is coefficient of variation. We do not call it as coefficient of standard deviation, but we call it as coefficient of variation. And the last one is the most important one, which we will be studying. But before going to that, first of all, we'll see what are the basic differences between these measures of dispersions. So right over here, differences. We will write all of them one by one. The first point under this that we are having, absolute measures takes the units in which data is given. Relative measures are unit free and generally expressed as a percentage. When we talk about absolute measures, point number two, absolute measures cannot be used in comparison of two or more data sets, whereas if I have to compare, then I have to use the relative measures of dispersion. So we say that relative measures are used in comparison of two or more sets of observations. And the point number three, which again you can remember for your MCQs, is the absolute measures are easy to calculate and comprehend, whereas when we talk about the relative measures, it is a bit difficult compared to the absolute measures. So we will say it is difficult to calculate and comprehend the various dispersion, relative measures of dispersion. Okay, so that is our basic differences. Now, like we had seen, the ideal characteristics and the requirements of the measures of central tendency, dispersion also has got some ideal characteristics and requirements. So let us write that also. You can call it as ideal characteristics or basically characteristics of an ideal measure of dispersion, both the ways. Point number one, should be based on all observations, should be rigidly defined. It should not happen that the value calculated in one place is different than the value calculated in the different place for the same set of observations and for the same measure of dispersion. Rigidly defined means that it should always have the fixed value. The value should not change like that. Number three, should not be affected by extreme values and by sampling fluctuations. And point number four, it should possess some desirable mathematical properties. Desirable mathematical properties means nothing but should be possible to apply for combining two or more groups. And the point number 6, in fact point number 5 over there, it says that it should be very easy to calculate and comprehend. These are some basic common properties. Some are common, some are uncommon between the dispersion and your central tendency properties that we had written. So we can write it as additional important point. This is a point which is common to all the measures of dispersion. That's why we are writing it in the beginning, so that you don't need to write again and again every time for all the measures that we are going to study now. So we have to say over here, common for all measures of dispersion. So the point over here is something like this. All measures of dispersion are not affected, or I can say independent of shift of origin, but they are affected only by absolute value of change of scale. Now when we talk about absolute value, so what is the meaning of absolute value? It means that it is the modulus of the change of scale, or say probably in easy language we can say positive value of change of scale. If the coefficient is negative, so we will ignore that negative sign and we will just take the positive value of whatever the coefficient is associated over there. Okay, so write the definition of range along with me. Range is nothing but the difference between largest observation and smallest observation of the given data. Say, for example, if I say if L is the largest observation and S over there is the smallest observation, and if I denote my range as R, so when we say it is difference between largest and the smallest observation, so the formula becomes very simple. R is just equal to L minus S. Suppose if we take a very easy example for range, where do we use the range in our daily life? Suppose if you have a shop of, let us say, ready-made garments, and you are seeing what are the revenue values that you have collected over a period of 1 week. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 days in a week. So I am considering 7 examples or 7 values over here. Suppose in the first day you have got a profit of 2500 rupees. On the second day you got a profit of 2000. On the third day you got a profit of 1750. On the fourth day you got a profit of 2700. On the fifth day, suppose you got a profit of 1500 rupees. Sixth day, suppose if it is Saturday, lots of customers have come, you got a profit of 6000 rupees. Sunday aa gaya, bahut sara customers aa gaya, acha khasa sale ho gaya, 9000 rupees ka, ya to suppose 9500 rupees ka tera sale ho gaya, profit ho gaya. So when I want to find out the range of my profit, as per the formula, I have to search for the smallest value in this entire data, which is 1500, and the largest value in the entire data, which is 9500. And as per the formula for range, I will say over here, 9500 minus 1500, तो कितना होगा रुपीस, सो दैट इज योर सिंपल वैल्यू फॉर द रेंज. ओके, दैट इज द बेसिक एप्लीकेशन ऑफ रेंज दैट वी कैन डू इन आवर डेली लाइफ. ओके, फिर इसके बाद एक इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट है जो अपने को पता होना चाहिए, विच इज लाइक दिस. रेंज इज ranges independent of the frequencies. So when we say that the range is independent of frequency, so whether you are given a raw data or an ungrouped data, same formula will be applied as well as for the grouped data. Again, I will say that R is equal to L minus S for all the three types of data. But I have to remember, in case of grouped data, L and S values will be slightly different than what we did in this particular example. In grouped data, L is the largest number which is upper limit of last class. S is the smaller value or the smallest number, which over here will be the lower limit of the first class. Okay, so that is the way we will be calculating the range in if you get across a grouped data. After this, the next thing that we have to know is the coefficient of range. Now, it has got a very simple formula. The first one that you have is the range itself that we have calculated divided by the largest observation plus the smallest observation. And if you remember, I had told you in the differences that we have to express the coefficients or the relative measures as a percentage. So in order to express as a percentage, I have to multiply this by 100. So I get one formula for calculation of coefficient of range, which is range upon L plus S into 100. Or probably, if you want, you can also say L minus S upon L plus S into 100 as your second formula, because range itself is L minus S. So that doesn't make a very big difference over there. Okay, so that is about your coefficient of range. Now, a very, very important property that you have got for range is like this. If Rx and Ry are range of variables X and Y, respectively, and if Y is equal to A plus BX, so I can say that range of Y is mod B into range of X. And why do we get it like this? Because I told you the important point that the measures of dispersion are not affected by shift of origin. So this A over here is denoting shift of origin, and B over there is denoting the change of scale. Or you can also say it as scale coefficient. So whatever is the scale coefficient, its positive value or the modulus value or the absolute value will be considered. The shift of origin value will be completely ignored when you are calculating the values of measures of dispersion. Okay, I'll give you an example for this so that you understand it better. If range of X is 3, find the range of 7x plus 2y is equal to 9. Just any random equation we are assuming over here. So first what we will do is, I will express the given equation into this format, which is the general format, y is equal to a plus bx. And from there I will be able to get the required value of the range of y. range of y if you are given this equation. Okay, so let us see. I will say that 2y is equal to 9 minus 7x, and therefore y is equal to 9 by 2 minus 7 by 2x. Now whatever number that is added or subtracted, just leave that. But the number which is a scale coefficient or the multiplied by the variable x has to be considered with the modulus sign, and therefore I will get over here range of y is equal to mod of minus 7 by 2 into range of x, that is going to be 7 upon 2 multiplied by 3, and therefore range of y is equal to 21 by 2, like that. Cottel deviation is denoted as QD, and it has got a second name, also called as semi-intercottile range. This is the second name which is given to the cottile deviation, semi-intercottile range. And you can say that it is defined as half of difference between upper quartile and the lower quartile. Now what is that upper quartile? The third quartile. And what is the lower quartile? The first quartile, which is Q1. So in case when I want to find out the value of quartile deviation, we have to take the difference between the values of Q3 and Q1. So I get over here Q3 minus Q1, and it is half of that difference. So half indicates I have to divide by 2. So basically it becomes quartile deviation is equal to Q3 minus Q1 divided by 2. That is the basic formula for calculation of your quartile deviation. We have seen how to calculate the quartiles Q1 and Q3 in the central tendency. So the formula or the method for those remain the same. There is no other method for calculation of the quartiles. After that, the next one that you have is coefficient of quartile deviation. Now see, there are two formulas for calculation of coefficient of quartile deviation. The first one that you have is actually similar to the previous formula. What did we see in the previous formula? L minus S upon L plus S into 100. So what is the largest observation over here in case of quartiles? It is Q3. What is the smallest observation in case of quartiles? It is Q1. So it is L minus S which over here is replaced by Q3 minus Q1 upon L plus S, which is Q3 plus Q1 into 100. So this is one formula that I have for calculation of the coefficient of quartile deviation. There is one more formula like we studied in the previous case for the range. We have seen the formula range divided by L plus S into 100. So because it was coefficient of range, the numerator was range. Whenever we are calculating for coefficient of quartile deviation, in case if I want quartile deviation in the numerator, here I am having Q3 minus Q1, but the formula for quartile deviation is Q3 minus Q1 upon 2. So what I do is divide numerator and denominator by 2. So when I divide by 2, what do we get? Q3 minus Q1 upon 2 divided by Q3 plus Q1 upon 2 into 100. Why do we divide by numerator and denominator? Because we have seen in the ratio and proportion that whatever number you divide in the numerator, same thing has to also be divided in the denominator. That's all. So what I do is Q3 minus Q1 upon 2 becomes your quartile deviation, and Q3 plus Q1 upon 2 has a special name called as median, divided by, in fact multiplied by 100. So from here you come to know a very important formula, which is of median. Since median is equal to Q1 plus Q3 upon 2 is a new formula that you have studied, which was not there in the previous case, central tendency, but here we have to come across this formula because you will see some question which is based on this. Okay. So that is about your coefficient of quartile deviation. Now there is a important property which is based on the quartile deviation, and I had already told you it is a common property for all the basic measures of dispersion. So we'll write that once again over here. Property: if QDX and QDY are quartile deviations of variable X and Y, quartile deviations of X and Y respectively, and if Y is equal to A plus BX, the scale coefficient is only considered, the shift of origin value is not considered while we are working on the measures of dispersion. So I can say over here that quartile deviation of Y is just modulus of B into quartile deviation of X, the same formula which we had seen for the range, a similar one in fact. It was Ry is equal to mod B into Rx for the range. Here it is QDY is equal to mod B into quartile deviation of X. Okay. Now there are some important characteristics of quartile deviation which are completely unique with the others. So we will write that. Characteristics. Probably you can say it is a unique characteristics. So good for you to remember and understand. Point number one: it is not based on all observations, not based on all observations, number two, it is least affected by sampling fluctuations and extreme observations, OBS denotes observations. And the point number three says it is only measure of dispersion which is suitable for open-ended classification. If 15 × 2p² - q² is equal to 7pq, then you have to find out the values of p and q, p is to q in fact, such that p and q are positive. Okay, so let us see. We start with our given information. 2p² - q² is equal to 17pq. Multiply this 15 inside the bracket and divide throughout by pq, because this pq is an element which we don't need over here if I want to find the value of p:q. So this will become 15 × 2 = 30p² - 15q² and each of them will get divided by pq and we will be left with 7 over here. So this goes away as well as this goes away. Now this 30 × p/q remains as it is, and here I am having 15 × q/p, which is equal to 7. So I leave this 30 × p/q as it is, but because I am interested in the value of p:q, I take a reciprocal of this fraction, and when I take a reciprocal, it becomes like this: 1/p/q is equal to 7. Now assume that p/q is a new variable, say a. So your equation over here becomes 30a - 15 × 1/a is equal to 7. Then on the left hand side, when you take LCM, you will get over here 30a² - 15 / a is equal to 7. Cross multiply this a on the opposite side. Subtract 7a on the opposite side. -15 is equal to 0. Now we have to find out the factors of this particular quadratic equation, with the help of which we will be able to get our values of a. So when I want to get the factors, it will be 30 × 15, which is 15 × 3 = 45, so I have to factorize 450. Let us start with 2. So this will go with 225. Then it can be divided with 3, so it will go with 75. Again divide by 3, 25 5 5 and 1. So you will get over here the factors: 5 × 5 = 25, 3 into 3 is 9, 9 into 2 is 18. What is 25 minus 18? 25 minus 18 is going to be 7. But because I want the value as negative 7 and the product over here is also negative, I will get minus 25a plus 18a minus 15, that is equal to 0. So in such a case, from the first two terms I can remove a common as well as 5 common. So in the bracket I will get 6a minus 5. From the remaining two terms just take out 3 common. So in the bracket you will get the value as, once again, 6a minus 5 is equal to 0. So you already know the quadratic equation. So 6a minus 5 is one term and 5a plus 3 is another term. Therefore a is equal to 5 by 6 or a is equal to minus 3 by 5. But what was a? A was the value of p is to q. So I can say p by q is equal to 5 by 6 or p by q is equal to negative 3 by 5. But question has clearly mentioned that p and q have to be positive. Therefore, we cannot take the second fraction. And hence, you will get the answer p by q is 5 by 6, or probably you can say p is to q is equal to 5 is to 6.